Big data can come from several different sources. One way to think about it is whether the data was produced by a human or whether it was produced by a machine. Humans generate a lot of data whether we mean to or not. The first thing that I want to talk about is intentional data. This is the data that you know you are creating. For instance, if you take photos, videos, or record audio or put text on a social network, you know you're doing it. You can also click like if you're on Facebook. When you do web searches, a record of the web pages that you have viewed are bookmarked. Your emails and your text messages. Your cell phone calls. If you read an ebook, the highlights, the notes in the bookmarks, and online purchases. All of these are kinds of data that do not exist until the person deliberately makes them happen, so these are records of human actions. What is interesting is that, in addition to these intentional pieces of information, there's also metadata. Metadata is data about data. You might call this second-order human-generated data. The idea is that, this is data that accompanies the things that you do, and you may not be aware of it. Interestingly, metadata can be enormous, sometimes larger than the actual piece of data you created. Perhaps, metadata is more significant than the actual data for the big data world, because it is computer-generated and is already machine-readable and searchable. Here are a few examples of metadata and what can be done with it. For instance, if you take a picture with your phone, you not only get the picture, you also get what's called the EXIF data. That stands for Exchangeable Image File Format, and this is the metadata that comes from a picture on an iPhone. Aside from the name of the file which you see at the top left, and that it's 3.1 megabytes, and the time that it was taken, near the bottom on the right side, you can see the GPS altitude, latitude, longitude and position, or partway up from that, you'll even see the GPS image direction. It knows which way you're holding the camera. This is an enormous amount of information that accompanies the photo that you get. For instance, if you take a picture with your phone, you not only get the picture, you also get what's called the EXIF data. That stands for Exchangeable Image File Format, and this is the metadata that comes from a picture on an iPhone. Aside from the name of the file which you see at the top left, and that it's 3.1 megabytes, and the time that it was taken, near the bottom on the right side, you can see the GPS altitude, latitude, longitude and position, or partway up from that, you'll even see the GPS image direction. It knows which way you're holding the camera. This is an enormous amount of information that accompanies the photo that you get. Another example is email metadata. There is a lot of information that accompanies each email. The four very common pieces are, who is it from, who is it going to, did they CC anybody, carbon copy anybody, and the time that it was sent. Now, one really interesting thing about this that you can do for yourself is that MIT has created a web app called Immersion that allows you to do a quick analysis of your own social network via your email account. I am going to show you the Immersion website. It's immersion.media.mit.edu, and what it does is, it takes those four pieces of information about your emails, and it puts together an image of the network. For example, here is the Immersion demo with fictional data. Imagine a fictionalized character, Tony Stark. He has information 6 years of emails, 20,000 emails to 159 collaborators, and what you can see is who was in his group. We have more to Travis than anybody else. It looks like Travis is connected with Tabitha, and you can change, for instance, how things are distributed over here. The number of notes that show, now we have more and more people showing up. We can make that a little bit smaller, and the strength of the links between them. What is interesting is that, for instance, when you do it to your mailbox, you might be able to find distinct group that shows for your family, for my job, and for people that you socialize with. There are sometimes people who connect several of those groups at once. But the interesting is that, this is just based on who you sent the email to, who it was from, the CCs, the time and the date, and that is how it is able to reconstruct your own personal social network. The last thing I want to show you is about Twitter. Now, one of the interesting things about Twitter is that, tweets are very small. They are limited to 140 characters. What is interesting about this from a research point of view is there is an enormous amount of metadata that accompanies each tweet. This image here was put together by an employee at Twitter, Rathi Krikorian. The information in the red is the content of the tweet. That is the stuff that you meant to put there. But look at all this other information that accompanies it in terms of whether there was a reply, a truncated version, the author's screen name and URL, the location, the creation data, the account, the number of followers, the time zone, their language, whether they have a verified badge, the place ID, the URL, the country, the bounding box, the application they sent it, and etc. It is an enormous amount of information. The metadata in this case is several times greater than the actual content. This is one of the most interesting things, and this is why Twitter, in particular, is a very rich data set for people who are doing marketing research or social connection research. In summary, there are all sources of big data, and one of the interesting things about it is that the metadata in particular does not have to be processed. It is already computer readable. It is searchable. It is mineable, and you can start to get information about it immediately to reach your big data analysis purposes.